This evening on The Rock Newman Show, a statue of Marion Barry will be unveiled on Pennsylvania Avenue on March 3rd, 2018. It will be one of only a few statues honoring African Americans in Washington, D.C. Cora Masters-Barry and statue designer Steven Weitzman visit the set with details. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Mayor for Life Marion Barry is a legend in Washington, D.C., and thanks to the hard work of his wife Cora Masters-Barry and sculptor Steven Weitzman, his statue will soon take its rightful place on Pennsylvania Avenue. Welcome. Thank you so much for both of you for joining us today.
Yeah. Good to be back.
Great to have you back. So look, just a couple of days from now on Saturday, March the 3rd, something really, really significant is happening here in Washington, D.C. There will be an unveiling of the statue of Mayor for Life, Marion Barry, in front of the district building on Pennsylvania Avenue, as we have said. And so with that event, there are so very many places we could start. Here's where I'm going to start. With this headline, it says, "What happened when D.C. chose a white artist to create the official Marion Barry statue?" And this is by the highly esteemed Roxanne Roberts from the Washington Post. Mm-hmm. So look, we're gonna do a look back. We're gonna do a retrospect. We're gonna go way back with Marion, way back with you, way back with all of you guys.
Oh my.
We're gonna get to that. But this headline here caused a lot of eyebrows to raise. My understanding is there had been some healthy debate and criticism about Marion Barry was such a proponent of empowerment of the black community. Why in the world was a white guy chosen to do his statue? And to those people that say that, you say what, Cora Barry?
Well, that was a God thing. That's really how I feel about it, mm-hmm. because there was a competition. Everybody had an opportunity to present, and the choice that was made was based on merit, and there was no real consideration in terms of race or culture because I wasn't there.
Because you weren't there.
Because I wasn't there.
Uh-huh. So when you became aware that a white guy had won the competition, what was Cora Barry's reaction?
Well, I didn't understand why some people of color didn't get that opportunity, and I didn't think they tried hard enough, and I was concerned on two levels. One, Marion's life was made based on empowerment, opportunities, open up doors, and I think that would be a furtherance of what he believed in. And secondly, quite frankly, I was thinking about the politics of it and the general perception,
sure.
looking back at what happened with King's statue, and I just didn't figure how I could explain to the public that this is how this happened.
Uh-huh.
So it was both personal, and it was also very political and philosophical.
And if I know anything about you, those things that you are perplexed by or that you are concerned about, you typically lift up all the covers. So what action did you take?
Well, there was no doubt after I looked at the competition that he was by far the most competent one of the people that competed.
Mm-hmm.
But I still didn't understand And this is something that hasn't really been discussed.
Mm-hmm. Well,
actually,
let's discuss it here on the Rock
breaking
Moment
news.
All right.
I thought, well, maybe we could do a partnership. We could bring in an African American sculptor or artist, and mm-hmm. they could do something together. Mm-hmm. And to their credit, they actually did try. We mm-hmm. struggled with that for how long?
A month
or so. Mm-hmm. We tried to have a collaboration. Mm-hmm. It just didn't work out. Mm-hmm. But at least I tried.
And as I understand it, Stephen, one of the things that was taken into consideration in making the selection was everyone taking a look at something that is universally accepted as one of the great sculptured pieces of art. Hmm. That was your sculpture of Frederick Douglass.
Hmm. Well, the way this normally works with an RFQ, request for qualifications, mm-hmm. which is the call that is sent out around the country for a project like this, you send in past work, a statement of interest, that kind of thing, your resume, and mm-hmm. from that they pick out finalists. Mm-hmm. And I've been very fortunate, and I did do the bronze sculptor Frederick Douglass representing Washington, D.C. in the Capitol, and that was one of my slides that, mm-hmm. that I had turned in. Mm-hmm. And so that may have had some influence, I'm not sure.
So having been selected to be the sculptor for this legend, mm-hmm. if you will,
yeah.
And having done the work for Frederick Douglass,
yeah.
looking back at your, what I'm going to call your formative years, because uh-huh. I want to kind of tie this together in a way that I look at your formative years and also look at Marion Barry's formative years, sort of some of the similarities and I want to compare the similarities and the contrast.
Okay.
So to give perspective as to how a Steven Weitzman has the understanding and the appreciation to be able to capture, I've been fortunate to see what's at the Prevail, the statue of Marion Barry that is going to be unveiled on Saturday. Mm-hmm. It absolutely took my breath away.
Thank you.
Because the statue, in my estimation, not so humble estimation.
Thank you.
I think I knew Marion Barry fairly well. Mm-hmm. It captured the essence of him, and that's a very, very difficult thing to do. So tell us about your formative years. I'm aware of your having access to a multicultural environment. Talk to us about your growing up, your formative growing up years.
My father died when I was 9 months old, so my mother raised my two older brothers and myself.
And your dad was an artist.
And my dad was an artist. Yeah. He died at 41.
Yeah.
So he didn't really have a chance to really pursue his career too much, but there were remnants of some of his work at home.
Mm-hmm.
We moved from New York to Los Angeles when I was about two, and we were raised lower middle class, poor, kind of the where we lived was kind of the edge of the poor white Jewish community and the start of the a little more affluent black community as you start heading east to East LA.
Mm-hmm.
And this was during the early 50s, and so right around 1960, 60 something, when busing was introduced into the LA school system.
Yeah.
That's when the children, the people that were in my schools, elementary, junior high, and high school, became more of a mixture. And mm-hmm. so the people I went to school with, the people that were teaching me were African American, were Latinas, and so on.
Mm-hmm. And what impact did that have on you? What impact did that have on you?
Well, I mean, see, the interesting thing, because people have asked me this question before, and the interesting thing about it is, to me, it's just natural.
Yeah.
There's no
while you're going through it.
Right. The impact would almost presume that, that you're one way and something happens and then you it changes you. Mm-hmm. This is how I was raised. Mm-hmm. This was just my progression. Mm-hmm. The seeing the world as it really is, multiculturally, multicolor, multi-religion, mm-hmm. is normal mm-hmm. for me because that's in my history. Mm-hmm. That's how I see the world. Mm-hmm. And consequently, the artwork that I've created since I became a professional artist at 19 has been reflected that, has always reflected that.
Uh-huh. Okay, so I wanna ask you something because people are talking about your artwork here. Mm-hmm. You have an engineering background of sorts or somewhere, you work on building bridges, I mean, literally structures that will connect one shore to another shore, right?
Well, I have a number of companies that all have to do with incorporating art in the public domain in some mm-hmm. fashion. So Marion Barry is public art under the auspices of fine art. Mm-hmm. But I have a company, Creative Design Resolutions. All we do is create aesthetics for highways and bridges. Mm-hmm. So our only clients are departments of transportation.
So Department of Transportation, ultimately, though, you do work building, helping those bridges, projects.
Highway, whole corridors, miles and miles and miles of interstate. We design we take the functionality of these structures and we make them contextually of the place. So it tells a story. Uh-huh. So you mentioned about a bridge going over a river.
Yeah.
We just finished designing, they're starting to build a bridge in Dayton, Ohio over the Great Miami River that has divided the city culturally, racially, and financially for years and years.
Yeah.
And this is a very historically rich place because on the west side is all African American. Mm-hmm. They've been kind of kept us under, you know, not doing well financially, but that's where the Wright brothers had their bike shop. It's a very historically rich area. Charles Dunbar, Lawrence Dunbar, the poet laureate, was his African-American friend of the Wright brothers. They close this bridge down once a year to march across it mm-hmm. in solidarity to the Selma March. Mm-hmm. So, in telling this story and designing it, that's the story that this bridge is going to tell. Mm-hmm. You see, so when mm-hmm. people drive across it, walk across it, they will know the history of this community.
Yeah, I made a note here, and I want to get this right.
Yeah.
Something occurred to me that perhaps the statue of Marion Barry is for you a bridge that is reconnecting you to a familiar community like your youth.
That's interesting.
We came to the unveiling, and it was an extraordinarily diverse group of people that came out to your studio. And so I'm just, you know, do you draw any correlation or any connection to working with Cora and working with the community to make this happen from your youth?
Cora and I are laughing because, do you realize that Cora and I were raised just a few miles from each other in Los Angeles?
Do you realize her daddy was the first Black Marine?
I did not know that.
Right?
Is that right? Fantastic. No, so it's...
Breaking news again on the Rock Minute.
No, this has just been a beautiful experience. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure this answer is going to speak to your question, but having Cora as intimately involved in helping to direct those subtle nuances to make Marion feel.
Such as, give me an example.
Well, you can only get so much information when you're doing a posthumous portrait or, mm-hmm. or statue. You're using photographs, you're using videos and that kind of thing, which are limited. Mm-hmm. Limited in their the moment in time and the lighting and the age and all that.
Right.
So I can glean so much information from that, but after that, mm-hmm. There's nothing mm-hmm. unless there's someone that knows them intimately enough, like yourself, or like Cora and some of her friends, that can speak to certain nuances, little things that you wouldn't necessarily get from those photographs.
Yeah. Yeah.
And at that point, I need help. This is why I say I didn't do this by myself.
Yeah, yeah.
This was a collaboration, and Cora was just a real doll to come by and do that.
knowing that this was going to happen, was there something from your loving, caring, supportive, artistic side of Marion that you, it was critical to be captured within the sculpture? Did you have that kind of thought process?
It was an evolution. It really was. Okay. Starting out, I never anticipated that I would be so intimately involved. I knew that if he called, I would provide cuff links, shoes. He wanted to make him as lifeline as possible. I provided those things.
Right.
But as time grew, he would ask about, you know, those things he just spoke of. And because I have the same issue, I look at it so much, I knew it wasn't quite where it's supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would bring people, and Rosalind, for instance, walked in and says, oh, his face is not that wide.
Who walked in and said that?
Rosalind. I brought Rosalind with me.
Uh-huh. And a friend of yours.
A friend of mine.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I would say, well, don't tell me, tell him. And I mean, I wish you could see. She walked over to him and she's talking and he's sculpting. And I mean, the process was magical. He was just working. And she said, no, I'm over here. And I mean, so that started being more and more what we were doing. And then, you know, every little thing and I'm finding out because I don't know a lot of artists, but they say it's unusual. He was very open and insisting on people giving him feedback. And I understand from everybody we've interviewed that most artists aren't like that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So he
they
really,
have larger than life egos.
Yes, and they got,
know
I know
better,
what I'm doing and you
than,
can't tell me. And,
uh-huh.
And so nobody's asking you to say that because I know you would never say that, but it's true. but he was the complete opposite. So when someone said to me, well, how did you know it was going to turn out like that? It could have ended up being some complete opposite. I said, there was no room for that. Mm-hmm. He just did not allow that.
Mm-hmm.
Every little thing he said, what do you think? Mm-hmm. Are you happy? This is what. Mm-hmm. And I mean, so as you went, you were much a part of the process, even though I know nothing about it.
Mm-hmm.
I have no knowledge or any background in it. He just insisted, you know, that I, you know, it's the hand like this, it's the hand. I mean, it was mm-hmm. just amazing. It was, I can't even explain how intense that process was.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so glad it's over with. It was a lot.
You know, so there wouldn't be a statue if there weren't greatness to the man.
Right, right.
So, and we're going to get into that greatness in just a moment. Mm-hmm. But before I go to that category, I want to ask you, you had to get cufflinks
mm-hmm.
and you had to get different things. I can only imagine that every time that you had to do that,
mm-hmm.
there was an additional reflection of Marion Barry.
It was like I said to someone, it was like the longest funeral ever. It was like, you know, you were constantly being reminded, bring this. And you know, when you bury a loved one, you bring their clothes to the funeral home and then that's over with.
Yeah.
Well, this went on for 6 months. I mean, it was just bringing. So it was interesting because it was a roller coaster of emotion.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, at least I think when I saw different phases of it, it had a certain impact on me that I didn't anticipate. He warned me, but it did happen.
Yeah.
So it was
there
difficult.
Any particular thing that you went to look for that you were trying to find that stood out more than the rest? Was there any particular moment in this process?
Well, there was a moment when, and it was a long moment, when I decided that I wanted to change what he was going to wear.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, Marion used to wear these Nehru suits.
Yeah.
And so I brought one to the studio. It had the mud cloth collar.
Yeah.
And he's so patient and he's so generous and kind. I didn't realize how difficult and impossible that was going to be. I was emotionally committed to him wearing that Nehru suit.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't know about the process.
With an African accent.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
And I mean, I just was committed from my very essence
until
I think maybe one of my friends said, well, nobody's going to know that 20 years from now, 100 years from now, they're going to think it was like he's in a prison suit. And I started really thinking about, I know what it is.
Yeah.
But that process has to be a universal process. Mm-hmm. And I didn't realize also that they said they would have to go back and get reapproval. And the approval process, I think you said 7 different.
Oh, God.
Yeah, so to get it approved.
So many organizations.
But that was the one thing that sued. I was very emotional about that.
Mm-hmm. I used the term earlier, your formative years. You know, we start the show here by saying that we want to showcase, you know, extraordinary achievement. And so I want my viewing audience, and I'll take the liberty to do something here, kind of almost in some chronological order, that if you have your child that is out there that is committed or has a dream of any sorts, understand that who they become when their greatness shines through has much to do with their formative years. Marion Barry was born in beneath abject poverty in Itabena, Mississippi. At 7 years old, started picking cotton. And by the time he was 15 years old, he had a paper route, a very industrious guy, had a paper route where he won a particular contest to go to New Orleans. The paper had a contest to go to New Orleans. As an African-American kid, he won the contest. He hustled and won the contest, but was denied the opportunity to go to New Orleans because of segregation. Hmm. So when we talk about formative years and what seeds are planted, what seeds of greatness are planted, they can always be from a trial that ultimately yields an incredible testimony. Hmm. What did he tell you in all the years that you were together, first as just best friends for many, many, many years, and then the unlikelihood of you guys getting married? Talk to us about what he shared about his formative years. And of course, I know you knew his mother well also.
Mm-hmm. I always say Marion came from a background where black people were only able to go to the zoo on Thursday. Mm-hmm. That sort of summarized the life that he led in terms of oppression, segregation, and marginalization. Mm-hmm. Some kind of way, Marion was the first one in his family to graduate from high school, mm-hmm. let alone go to college. Mm-hmm. Something was born in him, just like I think something was born in him to create, something was born in Marion to uplift and to be the great man that he was. So wherever he was, he was up against the odds. He insisted on getting the principal of his high school fired.
Yeah.
His environment never held him back. It fueled him.
Yeah.
It fueled him. But he always talked about only being able to go to the zoo on Thursday. Mm-hmm. That all he always went back to that because that sort of symbolized to him.
You know what? You mentioned talking about him being able to go to the zoo is a segue for something that I wanted to talk to Steven about. And that was you spending 2.5 years at the zoo here in Washington, D.C., carving a tree.
That's right.
Now, aside from someone perhaps wanting to commit you to what used to be St. Elizabeth.
Right.
Tell us about that time and the work you did on that tree there at the zoo.
Well, if you were able to see over my career, you'd know that there are occasions that I just decide, I get it in my head that I want to do something, and I just will go ahead and do it. And the tree at the National Zoo was an idea I had to sculpt a tree dedicated to the volunteers. There are all these volunteers that volunteer to the Smithsonian to take care of the animals, take care of the property there. And I thought that was a worthwhile effort because, again, it involves everybody, all walks of life, all countries, and all of that, all with one single purpose. And I those things impressed me. So I went to the Smithsonian, the director, and all that, and I discussed it with them, and they approved it, and I worked on it. I was one of the, I guess, animals at the zoo for 2.5 years. I mean, and people would just come and watch me while I, you know, was carving this tree.
You were doing that as a volunteer?
And I was doing it. Well, I was getting, I guess the Fonds, the Friends of the National Zoo, were getting some donations, but it was an act of love because, you know, my real job paid for me living, and then I would just go there, and I worked on that for 2.5 years.
I just had to ask that question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Back to Marion. So you talked about him going through high school and then in college. In college, he challenged a memo. As a college student, he challenged a memo of the Board of Trustees at Lemoyne College. And it almost got him kicked out of school. The guy had said something that Marion thought was demeaning. And he challenged him. It became a major newspaper story, and so some kind of way he remained intact, was able to graduate, and what so many people don't know was an intellectual brilliance, an academic brilliance, where he earned a master's degree in 1960 and was very close to a PhD degree in chemistry before the call and the pull of the civil rights movement.
That's right. Marion, I say all the time, Marion was a strong, brilliant, courageous, free black man. And so all of those things come together. He, very, very smart, genius to me. A lot of people don't know that about him because he's such a street dude, you know, so accessible, so down to earth. That, you know, he's an extremely intelligent person. I mean, a PhD in chemistry even today is difficult, but back then, in addition to all the things, all the odds that were against him, but he put that down and went into the civil rights movement. But Andy Young did a video for the unveiling on Saturday, and he said that Marion was the first one that took the movement and brought it into government. So all of those things that he did, founding SNCC, being the first national president of SNCC, Freedom Rides, all of those things, he took that to D.C., free D.C. He was the number one enemy to Lyndon Baines Johnson.
We're gonna get into all that, the government service and how his organizing skills from time past helped him in his whole entire political life. Before that, though, we have a different folks who've appeared on this show, and in one way or the other, they've had comments to make about Marion Barry. One of those was the radio and television mogul, Kathy Hughes. Let's take a look.
It took my audience, a family, the Flukas family. John Flukas, may his soul rest in peace, said to me, "We need to open your eyes. You need to really see what Marion Barry has done for this city. You need to understand that nothing gets done in this city that doesn't include black folks because Marion Barry." Okay. When I start meeting people who are doctors, lawyers, entrepreneurs, accountants, all who had started off as kids with Marion Barry.
Cable TV owner.
Bob Johnson, okay. Absolutely, no question about it. Marion Barry was so pro-black. I have a friend who says Marion Barry was black. Okay, he was committed to his people and his community. And so now I say that I wish Marion Barry had a run for president instead of mayor, because there wouldn't have been any police brutality. Okay, no, you will not be killing my people like this. Marion Barry was so instrumental in the development of black culture, history, and legacy, that I just pray that his story gets immortalized in that museum. Our new museum is wonderful, but it doesn't have enough Marion Barry in it. Cora Barry makes me feel so good because she said, "I gave him his flowers while he still was alive." She said that Marion Barry day that we did just a month before he died was his. She said he cried all day long, that he cried the whole month before he died because he was so thrilled that people from around the world called in to tell him thank you for what you've done for black people.
So,
and she's going to be on the program Saturday.
Yes, Saturday.
So and declaring Marion Barry Day Friday again.
That's fantastic. That is fantastic. So, Stephen, hearing that kind of testimony about a Marion Barry, Were those the kinds of testimonies that you did in research in attempting to capture him? Because in order to capture him, it's much more than just molding clay or iron or steel or whatever it is. It's capturing not just this physical essence, but the essence of the man.
Right, right. Well, all of that has to come into play. If you're doing your job, well, same as you. I mean, you've done your research, you've done your homework, and we have to do ours too, because that's what informs the sculpture. As Cora was saying, just to get those little details right, the shoes, the cufflinks, and things like that. But just how he walked, where he came from,
right.
You know, how he carried himself, mm-hmm. how he greeted people, mm-hmm. how he looked at people. All of this is informs the sculpture and the design, you know, the composition, the gesture, and so on. Mm-hmm. And you'll notice this when you look at the piece, that he is not standing like all the other statues you see in Washington, D.C., very stoic and raised up high on a pedestal.
Yeah.
He is in motion. He is moving this way, and he's being, somebody's calling him, and he's gesturing over to the side like he always was. Always in motion, always present, always available to everybody.
Yeah. I'll take the liberty as the host here to again talk about the prevail when I saw the tarp come off and saw him standing there and again waving with that big hand, and I was like, wow, this is going on Pennsylvania Avenue, and here's this brother there with this big hand, and this guy down at the White House so insecure about his hands.
Rock only you.
About his hands. That was not lost on me.
Yeah,
I don't know whether that was intentional or unintentional, but real.
He will be greeting every single person coming down Pennsylvania Avenue from now on.
Yeah, and you know what? I think it's ironic to hear you say that he will be greeting everyone coming down Pennsylvania Avenue from now on, because having sort of been intricately involved in Cora's and Marion's life through the years, I remember her being her, and that sometimes she gets frustrated and she wants to go somewhere. Or a whole bunch of times she would want to leave an event or church or
is
wherever they might have been. And
can't get Marion out. people stop and talk to him, and more importantly, he stops and talks to them.
Yeah. Well, that's a beautiful thing though.
By name.
By name, want to know where they came from, who they people, where they work, where they went to school, how many kids they have, and he wanted to know, he was sincere about knowing, and he never forgot.
And you know something else on that subject, Rock? Do you know how many people I have met since I started this project? In fact, just at the site where it's going to be dedicated, one of the guards guarding that area walked up to me, grabbed my hand, shook it, looked at me dead in the eye with all sincerity he could get in his heart, and he said to me, I gotta thank you. I gotta thank you for doing this. Do you realize I got my first job, my first summer job through this program of Marion Barry that he started?
Yeah.
I met dozens of people that said the same thing to me, that the first job they ever had was this summer job from the program that he started that became a program that the country emulated.
Yeah,
I mean, it's remarkable. And these are things that I didn't know about as to this kind of detail until I started the project.
Yeah, and you know, we clearly do not have the time in this hour to really go through that, because that's one of the legacies. That's one of the unmistakable pieces of his legacy that is incredibly, that's one of many, many highlights.
Yes, indeed.
Again, as I said, different folks on the show here had different commentary about Marion. Here is current Ward 7 council member and former mayor, Vince Gray.
Ah.
Let's take a look.
Yeah.
Mayor for life, Marion S. Barry.
Mm-hmm. A phenomenal, phenomenal human being. Marion Barry, hopefully, as time continues to wear on, will be remembered for the things that he did. I mean, there's so many people who across this city that you meet will say, I got my first job from Marion Barry.
Yeah.
you know, because he created the Summer Youth Employment Program. Right. You know, and I was proud to be able to continue it as those before me did, and hopefully everybody after, you know, me will do the same thing. Frankly, there are so many people who have professional careers. Yeah. Because Marion opened the door to African Americans in the District of Columbia who might otherwise not have had those chances. Mm-hmm. You know, those things are taken for granted at this point. But when you think about when he came along, you know, he was the he was on the first council, I guess it was, of the District of Columbia. Okay. He was the second elected mayor. Mm-hmm. And some of those vestiges of the past were still very much there.
Oh, it was Southern. It was
absolutely.
This was the old Southern boy.
Absolutely.
Southern run city.
That's right.
Yeah, and here's this guy coming in with the big afro and the dashiki.
That's right. But, you know, he obviously was one of the leaders in the civil rights movement, mm-hmm. and he brought that commitment, effort mm-hmm. To the District of Columbia in his political leadership. You know, if you go back, of course, you know that Marion was the guy who started Pride. He and Catfish Mayfield started Pride and created jobs for young people. And then, as brilliant as Marion was, a lot of people don't realize that Marion, if he had done his dissertation, he would have a PhD in chemistry.
Right.
He's brilliant.
Yeah. That's Marion Barry, the city council person, the president of the school board, the mayor multiple times, and then city council person for the last 10 years of his life. Something I want to stress, and I'm going to read this. In the aftermath of the 1968 Washington, D.C. riots, which followed the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. in Memphis, through Pride Incorporated, which Vince Gray just talked about, Marion organized a program for free food distribution to poor black residents whose homes and neighborhoods had been destroyed during the riots. Mr. Barry convinced local entrepreneurial giant here, Giant Food Supermarkets chain, to donate the food. Mr. Barry then spent a week driving trucks and delivered food throughout the district's housing projects. Now, I bring that up because the greatest of our leaders are the leaders who are willing enough, brave enough, humble enough.
That's right, that's the word.
To be of most service. Mm-hmm. So at a time when he was emerging on the political scene, becoming extraordinarily popular and well known, he drove the trucks to feed those in need. Mm-hmm. And if I remember so many things through his career, it was that willingness as an elected official to continue to remain of service.
Mm-hmm. And to remain, with the people. I had an experience this weekend, and I went to two churches. One was a really wonderful church. The patronage was from middle class to upper middle class, maybe some working class people. And then I went to his church, and it was just very clear that it was from working class to poor, 90% of them. And I just smiled, because I didn't know what Jesus did. I was like, Marion could be at any church in this city, mm-hmm. but this is where he was, with the people. It was just something that perhaps I didn't recognize when he was alive, but it just was very poignant to me, to the point that I started crying.
Yeah.
These are his people. He went everywhere. He was kings and queens and all over the world. Always was with the people, serving the people, connecting with the people, eye to eye, meeting them where they were. Mm-hmm. Never judging, never removing. To this day, I still live in Ward 8. I live right in the community. He never tried to live anywhere else, and he could have.
Mm-hmm. And as a person of the people would show so often in so many different ways their admiration and their respect for him. I mean, we certainly can talk about, you know, the difficult days that he had, but the appreciation and respect that they had for him, one thing, it was demonstrated at the ballot box. Mm-hmm. They couldn't wait. When he ran for city council after having served time in prison, he won by what I think remains the most overwhelming margin in D.C. electoral politics after having absolutely been pronounced and what everyone thought was correctly so, politically dead. Mm. So they reelect him to show their love. Another form was something that I was involved in that I just want to take the liberty to share. So we're doing this big boxing match. Riddick Bowe is on his way to the heavyweight championship of the world. And we record a message from Marion while he was in prison to say hello to the people who were attending the fight that night. Well, there were introductions of celebrities. There were introductions of District of Columbia.
I remember that.
Officials, including city council members and the mayor. I think we had gotten a warning in advance not to do it, but I think we forgot. And we played this voice. 10 seconds into the recording, there was a standing ovation as if God was speaking. And we got a serious fine for having played that recording that we weren't given permission to record. But I just bring that up. It again was a spontaneous reflection right. of love of someone right. who had been castigated, who had been gone through the legal system and called the son of Satan. Mm-hmm. But those who he meant so much to mm-hmm. were hell-bent on staying loyal to him and lifting him up.
Well, let me just spread that a little bit. Here at your alma mater, HU, you know.
Howard University, uh-huh. greatest institution of
yeah,
learning
of course, of
in
course.
The history of the world.
Of course.
Okay.
So we're at the greatest, one of the best things you could ever do at Howard University is go to their graduation. Yeah. So we're mm-hmm. going to the graduation, traditionally late as we were to everything. I'm always embarrassed, and I'm like, Marion, let's just sit back here. Let's just stay back here because the graduation has started. Let's just sit back here. We got a seat up there. So as he's walking, now these are not DC residents, as he's walking to our seat, the whole graduation class stops and these kids say, oops, there he is. Somebody was speaking. Yeah. And the kids, the whole graduation class, mm-hmm. I was like, I couldn't believe it. Mm-hmm. They stood up mm-hmm. and said, oop, there he is. Mm-hmm. So it goes beyond
yeah.
Washington, D.C.
Yeah. Okay, so you talk about him, you know, walking up, yeah. you know, wanting to get those seats and sort of not having that filter that that maybe being late was inappropriate. It just that kind of didn't necessarily register. But just to talk about him walking. Stephen?
Yes, sir.
The sculpture captured... Obviously, it's not a mobile figure where you got something animated and him taking steps.
Right.
But you captured this man's gait and walk without him moving. And so we could spend time talking about Marion Barry's walk or his strut.
Right, his gait.
The very, very dignified manner that he did somebody told me the other day when I saw my bad knee, they said, oh, I see you pimping. It was short of a pimp. It was a cross between a strut, a glide, a slide.
It was a swag.
And
it
Marion had swag long before swag.
Yeah, he had swag now.
How did you do that, man?
Well, you know, like I said, some of this is just comes from history, you know what I'm saying, where I was raised. But he had a certain way of carrying himself. He always carried himself with his head up. I don't know if you noticed that about him.
Oh, yeah.
And he walked with a little bit of that left-hand drag, just a little bit of that, you know? And so there was that in the gesture. Uh-huh. And because I didn't... as you said, the most difficult thing in doing a sculpture, which is by nature staid and finite, it's not dynamic, it's not kinetic, is how do you create motion in something solid and that's not going to move?
Mm-hmm.
And so I tried to catch him in this in-between motion where he is moving in this direction, but it looks like somebody's calling him from over there, so he's turning and he's waving towards them.
Yeah.
And so you'll see that in-between moment where he is acknowledging you, mm-hmm. the public. Mm-hmm.
So again, we said, we keep on saying it, so much a man of the people, but so much a visionary also, and someone willing to not just talk the talk of a visionary, mm-hmm. but to walk the walk.
Literally.
He was one of the very first voices that talked about Martin Luther King Day, mm-hmm. having Martin Luther King Day. And when Richard Nixon, back in the early 70s, had this great ceremony to recognize the Apollo astronauts that had walked on the moon, Marion's very erudite position was, well, why are we celebrating somebody walking on the moon when poor people can't walk safely in their communities here? Mm-hmm. Why don't we do something for those people? Mm-hmm. That kind of insight, that kind of vision. Go on.
That kind of commitment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, again, I said we went to the break. You know, they released these tapes of presidents.
Yeah.
And I did not realize until I started, because I'm a political scientist, as mm-hmm. you well know, mm-hmm. and taught it for over 20 years. And one of my specialties was studying the presidency. So I'm always interested when the presidential tapes come out. Mm-hmm. And I got the biggest kick out of the fact that Lyndon Baines Johnson referred to Marion as that SOB, Marion Barry. Mm-hmm. He gave him so much hell because he was fighting against the plantation mentality and against the colonialization, and he was fighting against the president. And he had more problems with Marion than he did with Martin Luther King. I didn't know that till I started listening to the tapes.
Yeah. And, you know, again, for our audience who might not understand, this is someone who has emerged, again, with the big afro, at the time wearing the dashiki, and with the school board on the city council, and the D.C. government was absolutely controlled by an old white boy network that had its southern roots and had absolute disdain for someone who would be so bold to attempt to show their pride in their blackness, in their African heritage. Did he rub them the wrong way? Oh, yes, he did. Okay. Also, I think part of what shocked the power structure from this guy, this kind of Superman guy here, well, he probably became more Superman after the incident I'm about to talk about, but he got shot. Mm-hmm. He got shot in the line of duty. I asked him during an interview one day, I said, Marion, how did it feel to get shot? He said, man, I just remember that bullet was so hot. The bullet was hot. It was hot, and I saw the blood, you know.
The only reason he survived because it was a ricochet bullet.
Yeah.
And he went on the wall and then hit him this close to his heart.
Oh, yeah. He continued. Mm-hmm. He continued. Never, ever took a step back.
But before you go with that, though, mm-hmm. once it was clear, because I said this on the radio last night, I don't know if you were here or if you remember that, but there's a shot of Marion on the stretcher.
Yeah.
Clear that he's going to survive, had a little Band-Aid, and he had been thinking about really planning to run for mayor.
Yeah, yeah.
And he literally started campaigning.
Because.
From the stretcher. I just like, no, Marion, you cannot be doing that.
In a whole lot of people's opinion, Marion Barry and Bill Clinton are two of the greatest natural politicians in the history of this country. Mm-hmm. And that is a reflection right there of a politician.
I'm here for the people.
Please. Right. Don't. Now, so we fast forward and jurisdictions, DC, Virginia, Maryland are vying. They are vying to get the Washington Bullets whose lease in Landover, Maryland is up. Mm-hmm. And Marion had just been reelected.
Miraculously reelected.
Oh, my Lord. Again, the return from the political dead. The Washington Post and the person that's running, everybody mm-hmm. denigrated this man. You just could not imagine that there was a possibility of winning, coming back and becoming the mayor once again.
Like a phoenix.
truly like a phoenix, truly exemplary of what he was, what he said so many times. If you got knocked down, look up. If you can look up,
you can get up.
You can get up.
You can stand up.
You can walk. You can walk and you can run. Truly example of that. But what he did was, I remember the relentlessness of which he pursued against the odds Abe Poland at the time, mm-hmm. and convinced Abe Poland through the force of his personality, through the policies that he demonstrated, knowing that if he could attract Abe Poland down here on 7th Street, right. that would spur economic development in the city.
Right.
Again, it was against all the odds, and got the Washington Wizards and the hockey team to come in and started the resurgence. So far from just a guy who knew how to talk to poor people, okay. he was a guy who knew how to make very, very big things happen.
He's a visionary.
Well, yeah, but it's not, well, he was also, he knew how to do business. That's what that's what the developer said. He knew how to do business.
And you say developers, mm-hmm. talking about him knowing how to do business. A developer that he had a great impact on was on our show. Mm-hmm. He talked about Marion also. Let's take a look. Don Peoples.
I had the great opportunity of growing up in Washington, D.C., and frankly, the mayor of the city believed in me and gave me my chance. And I think that is a big part of it. But anything's possible if you prepare yourself and you are willing to dream big. No matter where you are born, where you grow up, if you grow up in Ward 8 or in Congress Heights, struggling in public housing, it's going to be hard, but you can get there. And that would be what I would want people to understand, is there's no limitation. But we got to have people in a system that believe in our young people and feel compelled to give them an opportunity. So there would be no way, say, that any other mayor coming up at this time could be as transformational as he was, because like that, he just decided, Bob Johnson, who's a good friend, would not be as wealthy and successful as he is today if it wasn't for Marion Barry, because it was Marion Barry who awarded him the cable television franchise for the District of Columbia that gave him the money and the resources to build BET. No mayor could do that today.
You know, you talk about individuals, Don Peoples and Bob Johnson, but I'm going to take the liberty to read this talking point unashamedly. It says, out of his efforts emerged one of the most successful and powerful black middle-class communities in the world, which helped shape black culture in the nation's capital and the United States. You know, so often leaders get in position, people take positions of leadership and don't lead. They're kind of afraid of their surroundings and rocking the boat. Not something that you could ever attribute to a Marion Barry. He got in leadership and took executive action that made a tremendous impact on people.
Absolutely. It's interesting because when Marion ran for mayor, he was running against the incumbent mayor, first time elected mayor, and the incumbent chairman of the city council. So he was this firebrand. He just kind of came up through the middle. And the Ward 8, the white people primarily elected Marion the first time because he was the opposite of the other two. Mm-hmm. The black vote was split between the three of them.
Yeah.
And that first term is when he took the police department, turned it around.
Yeah.
He used to call it an occupied army.
Yeah.
Black police chief, a black fire chief. He did the set aside 33% for a minority contractor. By the time he did that, the white people abandoned him.
Yeah.
And they never voted for him again in any kind of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
But by that time, all the black people were on his side. So that's why he was able to eternally have their support. But he did do that. He went there and just changed the paradigm. I mean, he just shook it up.
Yeah.
He didn't do it gradually. He just shook it up.
And once when asked, how did he feel that the white community no longer embraced him, those famous words, they just got to get over it. I got to mention a couple of things.
Okay.
His youth initiative, the Mayor's Youth Leadership Institute, was a great institution that was established. And somewhere it is said that if you ever wanted to get on the wrong side of Marion Barry, do something that would negatively impact on the seniors. That's when you would see a raid, that you could also see the guy who really had a, you know, happy-go-lucky kind of attitude most of the time in his life get really upset, don't do anything with the seniors. And so I'll end again here with a personal reflection, thanking you guys so much for coming here.
Thank you.
But I talked to my brother about Marion Barry, and Marion established the Minority Business Opportunity Commission. My brother was a cement truck driver, and for about 15 years, he got passed over by the people who were the management and ownership of this one company that I'll tell you, it's Super Concrete. He worked there. My whole family worked there. And he continued to get passed over when he should have gotten promotions. Mm. He went out and saved his money. He became a part of this Minority Business Opportunity Commission. And he owned his own company. And he hired 90%+ minorities. And because Marion Barry started the Minority Business Opportunity Commission, my brother named his concrete company Opportunity Concrete. Those are the kinds of things that Marion did, that he made people's lives, you know, in a big way, a small way, and an extraordinarily comprehensive way. So the testament that we're going to see, the honor that we're going to see bestowed on Saturday, thank you both so much for working to put it together. It is something that the Mayor for Life truly, truly deserves.
Yeah, forever now.
Forever and ever and ever.
Yes,
folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to whut.org. Goodbye and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.